I'm Avinash Rao. I head consulting at DevOn. I'm going to be talking today about transformations for agility. The theme of today, and you'll hear this repeatedly over the sessions, is agility and transformation, not necessarily agile, DevOps, etc. Those are important. We'll talk about those as well. But we wanted to set the theme as transformation. And what we wanted to do is really establish a little bit of a problem statement, get a little bit of thinking in around what transformations are. And that transformation really is a long tradition of changes which our businesses have been grappling with over a fair period of time. So it's not something that's new in digital or new in DevOps or new in Agile, etc. And let's see if we can arrive at some sense making in terms of what makes sense, what doesn't make sense, as we are going through our respective transformation journeys. But before we begin, I want to talk a little bit about the environment. Yeah, you heard that right. So I'm a bit of an environment fanatic. My wife and daughter are sick of me because every time I say, put the lights off, let's use these low power usage bulbs, even though they cost 10 times as much. And then this whole thing about putting geysers off and putting lights off when you leave the room and all that. And so they're really tired of me. And so one day, I had left the lights on in a great deal of the house. And I was sitting and working, taking a call, something. Then my daughter came up and said, Daddy, you've left the lights on everywhere. Don't you care about the environment? Don't you know we're going to run out of water, power, and everything in 20 years? And I said, Suti, can't you see I'm really busy right now? And then, one of the joys of being married to an MBA, so my wife came up and said, so, when we leave lights on, it's because we don't care about the environment. But when you, Avinash, leave lights on, it's because you're really busy, right? So, and then she said, you know what you're doing is called a fundamental attribution error. We believe that when we do something, it's because of the noble causes or several constraints that we have. But when somebody else does it, it's because they don't care about stuff, right? And so that got me thinking a little bit. And I started thinking, and that's the point of the story that I wanted to make, that if we are to have a reasonable, healthy discussions that doesn't go along the lines of your dad also leaves the lights on, baape macha, and all that, then we need something which we can both agree on, a framework. So there is utility in having a framework which enables us to take a discussion forward without it going into really, really interesting scenic turns, right? And this is what you hope in a high-trust relationship, right? You and your wife and you and your daughter. But what happens in scenarios in the absence of a framework, but you are attributing different meanings to the actions of partners, of vendors, or you're working between business and IT? What hope do we have, right? And what I hope to convince you, or at least get you started thinking on the topic of transformation, is that agility, digital, DevOps, etc., is just one in a series of transformations that we've been looking at over a period of time. It's not something that's come up now, it's not new, etc. And that there are lessons to be learned from the past. So we will pick the internal combustion engine just as an example, and we'll see how that maps to some of the themes that we are going to talk about today. So what happens in the early 1900s is that the horse and buggy was the primary mode of city transformation, car transportation, and cars were just coming in. And I like the picture of the horse. So I chose it over the example of people having secretaries who used to do a lot of work for them, and then computers and emails came in, and that's an example of another transformation. So back to the first transformation, where we are looking at the IC engine, the internal combustion engine. The internal combustion engines just come in, and there's a lot of talk going around about the equivalent of what we would call digital transformation today, except that it's an internal combustion engine transformation. And the horse and buggy guys are really worried. And so we say, me as a consultant, go in and say, Mr. Horse and Buggy Cart Owner, your business is being disrupted. right? And obviously you need help, you need techniques. And would you like a faster horse? I have this training program. It's called the Faster Horse trademark. We have trained 2,000 horses. They go faster, they'll increase your revenue by 30%. Because we'll train all your horses, we'll train all your coachmen. Does that sound familiar? I wonder where I've heard that before. And then you can show those cars, right? Because then you can go, you can do your business much better than you can do with her. The same discussion happening with the car companies. So you say, car maker, Ford Model T is disrupting your business. What are you going to do about it? Can you do market research to say, can we do cars other than black? Can we give a more variety, etc.? And there's also a great deal about market research, what customers really want. Can we help in your production process? Can we make you more efficient? The difference between the two conversations is that here, it didn't work. No matter what help the horse and buggy business would have got, they did go out of business. And here, to a great extent, the competition, the other players in the market, they did succeed. And there is a reason why the same approach that can work in one situation does not, will not work in another. And so if you really look at what businesses are facing in terms of their transformations, there are two dimensions to any transformation. The first dimension is that the transformation seems to move our businesses away the cycle time that says it will take us X amount of time to do a certain activity to economic time. One thing that comes to my mind immediately when I see this is it will take us three weeks to do a release, which is a activity cycle time. We're very clearly saying that, look guys, we in IT have a certain way of doing things, which leads us to a certain cycle time. But what businesses are really interested in is economic time. They're saying, by when will you help me achieve a certain outcome? The second thing that happens in transformations is that you have the business models will change. And what does that really mean for people who are undergoing that change? Is that they need to develop two different capacities. And the capacity can be either a completely new product, in which case you sell the horse and buggy business and buy yourself a bunch of cars, or you have to be able to achieve additional services, additional ways of serving your customers, which is a disruption to the way you are doing things currently, but that is a change to your delivery model. Both of these are incredibly painful. So just in case you were skeptical about me, this is a HBR model. So for those of you who are interested, I'm happy to share the link for that as well. But how does this discussion really help us in our theme today in terms of transformations, in terms of what we want to achieve via DevOps, via agility? You'll keep seeing that I say agility as opposed to agile because I make a distinction. We'll come to that as we go through this. So from what we've said so far, there's value in having frameworks, right? And there's also a great deal of value in understanding the nature of transformation that we are undergoing. And taken together, hopefully there are some things that we can learn. When you get down to a level deeper, then you start looking at religious wars. You start saying that, free the teams. Let teams be self-governing. Or we need to impose structure because we are large. We need a long architectural runway because our business is very complex. It takes us 6 months to do something before a team can actually work on something. There are all these stories that you hear about. I get a few every day about how Amazon, Facebook, Netflix can do stuff before you can even think. They're doing hundreds of releases every second, at least if you believe some of these articles. Then there are these discussions that say we want to do DevOps, but Ops is done by another partner, so we can't really do it, so can we do DevOps only for Dev? So there are all these religious discussions which are happening, and if this doesn't scare you, nothing else in my presentation will. And this is a live actual quote that a potential customer once said to me. He said, "Wahi hisa pata agile DevOps kya yaar, Avinash 2000 ke liye kuch naya batao." right? So a lot of people are treating these as frameworks, templates to be applied for a certain period of time, then it goes away. But that is not the nature of transformation. So what we're going to do is we're going to talk about a few cautionary tales, okay? We're going to go through four scenarios, and we're going to talk a little bit about frameworks after that and see how that applies and how that can help us in our transformation journey as we go through the day. So this was a large company. They wanted to completely move away from their mainframe-based business and disrupt their market. So they were doing complete new product development in an area that they've been in business for nearly 50 years. So they knew their domain really well, and they had a very set way of doing things. But if you're familiar with the airline industry, a lot of their work is on traditional systems, and those traditional systems you can't do data mining on. So they wanted to rip and replace the entire model, create something that they could do data mining on, and then be able to successfully do differentiated pricing, loyalty-based pricing, etc. But then what happened is that they said, we're a large company, we need to plan ahead. We've recognized a fundamental shift in the market, and what we're going to do is we're going to build this new product and capitalize on it. That was the ask, right? The second one, the heading kind of gives away what happened to each of these, but we'll come to what did happen with each of these. This second one is a small company, and this was out of the UK, scaling to take what's called a hockey stick takeoff, that you invest a great deal of money, build something that hopefully works, and then suddenly you get market adoption. So they wanted to be able to take advantage of that huge uptick in demand, which was coming in. Their entire success had been based on having Scrum teams doing work independently, high-quality Scrum teams that had the freedom to be able to do the right thing, to make their own architectural decisions, to make their own environment decisions, etc. And they were faced with a market opportunity where they had to really scale. And they said, okay, let's continue to use Scrum and then we'll scale the entire thing. What happened is that they completely failed to scale, and the product failed due to many, many issues. Primary among them, the structure to the transformation that they adopted. And we're going to talk about the framework and then come back to relook at this case again. More cautionary tales. There's a large company that wanted to do product development in a very regulated industry. So in a regulated industry, you're confined by government regulations and other body regulations. So you can't really do too much beyond what's permitted with those boundaries. But they said, we want to drive innovation. You know what? Without innovation, we're all dead. So they started with a let a thousand flowers bloom approach, where they said, each of you, we will give you some seed money. You can go in, you can innovate. Whichever works the best, we're going to bring that in, and we are going to promote that. Because, right, it's a free economy, innovation, everything's great. This was another example of it just completely failed to scale, and we'll see why. A final cautionary tale, a medium-sized company, I actually worked fairly closely with them. They came in and they said, I want agility. So obviously when the VP says agility, all the directors took out their notepads and they wrote Scrum, Agile. So they did a really nice Agile implementation. And at the end of the year, the VP asked a question, which unfortunately I've heard from too many customers too many times in multiple variants of the same thing. But at the end of the day, they just asked two questions. Did my profit go up? Did my cost go down? Right? If neither of these two things happened, it doesn't matter what rituals you did, it doesn't matter what increase in team bonding you did, at least from that VP's business perspective. Because they said every improvement that you have made throughout this entire journey of agility must reflect in one of two metrics. Did my profit go up or did my cost go down? So I just wanted to put this disclaimer there because I've actually been asked this. So I said, Avinash, why do you always do these cautionary tales, right? Do any of your projects actually work? So he said, yes, they do. This is transformations are hard. And I seem to have spent 18 years primarily doing some of these large transformational activities with customers and clients. Right, so let's step away a little bit and start thinking about the frameworks that I promised you in the beginning of the session. And say, so this is a mess, right? So how do we make sense of this? So to quote one of my favorite philosopher, Einstein, at least attributed to Einstein, no problem can be solved with the same level of consciousness that created it. So let's take a look at what might help us make sense, navigate through this entire journey. Before we go in, I've heard a lot of objections. People say, mere paas agile manifesto hai, DevOps framework hai, hamare paas your favorite thought leader, right? So we have to answer this question. Part two. So what does all this mean for us? There are two types of problems that we often solve. There are problems that are problems of efficiency, saying we know what to do, we just need to do it really well. I know what to develop, I just need to develop it faster. I want to automate it, I want to shift left, I want to increase my throughput. Those are problems of efficiency. There are also problems of effectiveness. Problems of effectiveness always come with discovery. I don't know what the market wants. I don't know what will succeed because I'm working on this new thing that I've never worked on before. So it's not a question of doing it faster or better. It's a question of discovering the internal capability as well as the external market input to even understand if I can succeed in doing whatever I'm doing, right? And so if you look at the box on the left, we know what to do, but we need to do it faster and more reliably. That's one part of the challenge that we often address. So in this, there are often two dimensions to solving an efficiency problem. One of it is speed, saying I do something and I do it reasonably well, I just would like to do it much, much faster, right? And there are tools and techniques which can help us do that. The second one is, I know what to do, but my quality isn't great. And this quality is from a conformance to specifications perspective. I know what my spec is. I just would like to deliver to that much, much faster. And on the right side, you have a different type of transformation, which are the what transformation, saying we're being disrupted, or we want to do something innovative, something different, which hasn't been done in our industry before, because we want to leapfrog and we want to become the market leader. And when we want to do that, this again has two dimensions. One is market responsiveness, and the other is, do we have the muscles to be able to lift the load that we now want to lift? If I've been somebody who's, I do a lot of trekking, and so I'm very comfortable walking long distances. But if I decided I want to do mountaineering now, I need to exercise my arms, because the muscles that I need for my mountaineering are different from the ones that I need for trekking, right? And so, how do we start building these additional muscles or this additional market insights? To give you one illustration, and if Noor's standing with the placard, fortunately I can't see him because he's in the dark, so I'll continue. People should know that consultants love the sound of their own voices, so we tend to keep going on unless somebody tells us, Noor, how much time do I have? I have only 5 minutes. That's unexpected. Okay. I'm going to take five more. I'm not going to be able to finish this in five. I'm going to give you an example first. I once worked, I joined a new company a few years ago, a couple of employers ago, and I joined as part of their Lean, Kanban, DevOps, the transformation group essentially. And the VP called me in on my second day at the job, and he said, Avinash, we have a challenge for you. It's really exciting. I said, okay, what is it? He said, there is a contract that we have signed. After we signed the contract, fixed price, fixed duration, the customers decided to do a rip and replace of the entire architecture, which has bumped up the entire effort by 30%. Now, the account manager has said, it's okay, we will do it in the same price. And since you know this Agile and Kanban and DevOps and all this stuff, right? You are going to help us deliver this on time and on schedule and on profitability target, right? So that it was actually a true transformational project. This company wanted to overhaul their entire account management. This was a hotels and resorts group in the US. And they wanted to overhaul their entire, the way they interacted with their customers, etc. But the way it was structured, we decided that it's not a problem on the right side, but a problem on the left side. And we said, we're going to take a view that whatever is written in the specs is what needs to be delivered. So what we did a value stream map of the whole thing, looked at where we could improve efficiency of delivery, and we managed to deliver what was written in the spec in the 6 months that the contract was due for. But is that what the customer really wanted? Because once we went into UAT, there was this usual familiar cycle where people said, yeah, this was in the spec, but this is what I really wanted. Then we made a lot of money on CRs, right? Because what was, in effect, a way to help a customer do transformation, it was a problem on the right side. You create enough boundaries and complications around it, people will solve it as an efficiency problem. A lot of us in the room, and I'm sorry, I'm speaking on your behalf, tend to approach problems as though they are problems of efficiency. Problems of efficiency are also easier to measure. And given a lot of our engineering training, we believe that, yeah, that's the way to go. Right? But keep in mind, transformations need new muscles, and they need market inputs, without which they will not succeed. So I have a framework here that I wanted to walk through. I will walk through the framework and then very quickly look at all the examples. I do want to say that we have a board here where you have any questions. We will put, please, there are sticky notes over there, pens, put them up. We will address them as we go through the day. Is the model clear? Is it readable? Essentially, this is a framework that's called the Kinefin framework. And it helps us navigate some of these transformations. Because five really, but the center is disorder. So there are some transformations which are simple, some which are complicated, complex, and chaotic. And Kinefin gives us a way to approach each of these transformations. It also gives us guidance in terms of what makes sense given the particular transformational problem that you're trying to solve. Kinefin means habitat in Welsh, actually. So it really says, if you're living in a habitat, a jungle of this kind, here's the approach that you should take. So if you have a simple approach, you can sense the situation, categorize it, respond. There are best practices that you can apply. And using these best practices, you can solve the problem that you're trying to solve. There are situations that are complicated where you have to sense the problem, analyze the problem, and then respond. And here's where SMEs come in, architects come in, people who've done this before, who can help with good practices. There aren't best practices, but there definitely are good practices that can be applied in this situation. A third is complex, where you have what's called emerging practice. So this is where your discovery of new muscles, the new capabilities that you need come in. There are no good answers or best practices. The path that you're on really determines the outcomes that you get to, because the path is created as you go along the journey. And then finally, there is chaos, where if you look at a lot of startups in the gaming industry, for example, you don't know what will pick up. So you do a release, and then you figure out, based on market response, how it is being received, and then you respond to that in turn. So without going into each of the new, each of the case studies and re-looking at it, the point is that if we don't understand what habitat we operate in, are we in a complex situation? Are we in a chaotic situation? Are we in a simple situation? And we don't understand what the fitment is of the transformational approach that we are taking. then we are doomed to, there will be a dissonance between the outcomes you want to achieve and the levers that you choose to achieve that outcome. So there's a couple of things which are very popular right now. There's a phrase going around that data is the new oil. So everybody's in on the oil rush. And the how that is used may not be very well understood by different companies. There are there's a famous model that says, in the beginning, data assists you in your decision making, then it augments your decision making, and then it automates your decision making. And if you are to be able to go along this entire journey, there are disruptions that will happen to your current decision-making process. Are you ready for that? Otherwise, the technology might be there. You may be able to do it, but you may not be able to land it because there are simply too many barriers in your transformations that you haven't thought about. Who's heard of the Target pregnancy story in the room? Okay, so Target in the US used to go around sending out these mailing coupons. And they sent out a pregnancy-related coupon to this young girl. And her father was furious. So he came into the store, Target store, and he said, what kind of a company are you? What kind of stuff are you sending my daughter? And then there was a huge hue and cry that, you know, data mining and all that is out of control. We're living in a horrible new world. 1 month later, the store manager went back to the house and said, look, we apologize last time we sent you a gift hamper. Is there anything else that we can do for you? And thank you for not suing us. And then the gentleman, the father said, you know what? My daughter was pregnant. I just didn't know it. Because they were looking at her purchasing and browsing pattern. And they determined that that matched somebody who's just pregnant. And they were able to do that with analytics, with predictive analytics. They also always feature on the top 10 lists if you do a Google search on their ability to do DevOps, right? So that's one example of where they did it well, at least from the perspective of the company. So going back to the cautionary tales, what I will do is skip a little bit because it's already past 10:15. And I do want to leave the last 10 minutes for Q&A, is that in this situation, it's a large company that wants to do a bleeding edge transformation. They approached it as though it was a simple or a complicated problem. They said, we know how to do development. We've been doing development for many, many years. Therefore, we're going to develop this new market-breaking product the way we've always done development. They just ran into so many issues where they discovered things about the new technology, about the new use cases, as they were building the product. And I think they wrote off a total of $200 million on this program. The next tale was about the small company scaling to take advantage. So while they were in the initial development mode, it was easier for them to work on Scrum, free their teams, let each of them choose their own ways of work. But faced with a sharp uptick in their growth, they simply couldn't get the outputs of all these different teams together in a cogent manner. So the output that they needed was to be able to scale that product significantly, but they simply couldn't achieve it by using their pure Scrum and Scrum of Scrums. The architectural runways that were needed to actually help the product scale simply weren't there, right? And another cautionary tale three, market product development in a regulated industry, there's actually no need for really large scale innovation here. The market is well defined. The regulators decide what you can and can't do. And this simply isn't an approach which will help them scale rapidly because this was actually an efficiency problem. And they tried to turn it into an effectiveness problem. Right? And finally, the ask from a business, and I keep saying this, is did revenue go up, did cost go down? And if people come and say, and this happens a lot in automation discussions, people say, we automated this, we automated that. How much money did we actually save with all the automation? Right? Even though there is a notional saving in terms of somebody spending 4 hours on it now instead of 2 days before. How did that reflect in the bottom line? How did that reflect in an increase in the throughput? Because it's very, very easy via automation to create a bunch of local optima. But unless you achieve an end-to-end throughput, you will not be able to translate that into your business results. So in summary, setting the theme of transformations for the day, the objectives of transformations that we want to achieve, we should understand how that maps into economic time, away from cycle time, which is the traditional activity-based cycle time that the process currently takes. And then DevOps, Agile, Digital are all levers to achieve the right outcome, if you know exactly what the outcome is. Questions? Can we get a little light? Yep. Thank you.
Hi, Avinash.
Hey.
So the question is about measuring the efficiency.
Yes.
Right? The point you are telling is, unless and until the efficiency measures are taken end to end, it is very tough to, show the
yes.
Correct? You know, this
yes.
is, but to do that, it yes. is going to take, sometimes it could be years, depending on the scale of what we are doing.
Correct.
Okay. So it is always challenging to show on a yearly basis.
Yes.
So have you faced any situations where, because getting a buy-in from CFO is going to be always a challenge.
Sure.
When we want to take some of the efficiency, automation or any
sure.
Self-servicing tools, whatever.
Absolutely.
Always. So can you share any situations?
Sure. I'll give you my perspective. I will preface that. I will make an assumption to your question that what you're trying to solve is truly an efficiency problem. You do want to do what you're doing. You just want to do it faster, increase throughput, do it for a lower cost. We will postulate that. If you are doing that, the best way to do it is what is called a thin slice. If you have a really large system, like most major enterprises, it is very hard to transform them all at once. I mean, nearly impossible. The only thing that you can do is to take a thin slice of your business process. Even that is hard, because as soon as you take a thin slice of your business process, it cuts across multiple silos and functions. And there itself, you will face enough resistance. But at least it's at a manageable level where you will be able to show the benefits of the overall transformation with a thin slice cutting across the entire chain. Once you prove that, I have often been surprised how quickly large companies will actually say, that is successful, okay, scale it. Because companies are very hungry for success. If you're able to demonstrate that success with a thin slice across your end-to-end, then in my experience, you can very quickly get buy-in from top leadership, which is really the only way you can make it happen in a large enterprise. Beyond a point, you need that top-down drive to make it happen. But you need to help them with the evidence, with a thin slice. Yes. Can we get the mic over there, please?
I think the biggest hurdle in transformation is the mindset.
Yes. Right?
So, and whilst the team who is developing or carrying out the change,
yes.
be it of an IT nature or be it of any business nature, even if they are bought into it, right, the other stakeholders are reluctant to adopt those framework or those policies. How do you get them on the other side?
So there's one almost a mantra, which is teams telling teams. If consultants, managers, even directors, VPs, etc., it's very hard to achieve that consensus across the organization because people have their own interests, people have their own points of view. The thing that works best is teams telling teams. If people have implemented something, they have made it successful, and that team goes around telling other teams that, look, here's what we have done, here's what we've been able to accomplish. that is the right way to spark it. That often gives incentive enough for other more political players to be able to align to that direction. In the absence of that success, it becomes a bit of a he said, she said. That, you know, I have a point of view, he has a different point of view, and there is no framework, no evidence that we can agree on that really says that, look, this is something that works. There are teams who are telling teams and helping them succeed, so let's move on that path. That's a way to solve it, or at least ease the pain. But you're absolutely right, it's often a very political process.